All right. My name is Juan Pelcone. I've been a maestro developer for the past 6 years. I was one of the first, amongst the first 10 employees to actually join the company. Back then when I joined, there was basically nobody in the company. It was just four developers, one marketing guy, and basically everyone else was just a co-founder. Back then, the current version we downloaded was 3.19. So that was a very long time ago. Our product was totally different than what it is today. Today, we've basically taken MySQL to an S level. We've been trying to endorse the enterprise market level, trying to make it fit for enterprises to use, and basically just to please each and every single user. We've tried to make them happy, and we followed a bunch of suggestions. So basically what we're trying to accomplish is we're trying to be the best open source database in the world. Let me get started with my presentation. I'm going to be talking about the cool features that were introduced in 5.0 and 5.1. There's been a lot of changes in the 5.0 branch. For instance, the information schema. The information scheme, I'm not sure if you're aware of what that actually is. It's a totally new concept from MySQL. It has existed for a couple of years in different databases, for instance, Oracle, DB2, SQL Server. All those databases have used the information scheme for a long time. MySQL just recently incorporated this design into the database. Basically, what this is, the information scheme is like a virtual database, okay? It's used to access metadata, where metadata is actually information from the data itself. So for instance, an example of metadata would be the columns of the table, the record names, things like that. By the way, if you have any questions, feel free to ask. This is not totally different than what we accomplished in previous versions with the show command. This is just a complement. The show command, which actually does a bunch of things which one can actually do with the information schema, will still remain. And as a matter of fact, we have in previous versions of 5.0 branch, we've actually modified the show command to enhance. We've enhanced the show command a lot. So that's basically it regarding the show command. Now, the interesting part about the information schema is, unlike the show command, one can actually specify each and every single field one wants to display. Because as this is a virtual database, which by virtual I mean it does not really exist in hard drive, it is hard-coded, it is in memory, one can actually perform select statements, joins, unbys, unions, and basically anything that you could actually accomplish using the select statements. This way you can display each and every single field you want. And for certain situations and scenarios, this is even actually better than the show command. For example, let's take GUI clients. GUI clients are great in this case. Previously, if you developed a GUI client, you would be dependent on the show command. For instance, show tables, and then you would actually have to parse each and every field displayed by the result set. And that was a lot of overhead for the client. That accomplished things in the client machine which weren't actually supposed to be accomplished in the client machine. With the information schema database, that is really trivial to accomplish. Well, just as any other database, the information schema resembles each and every single database you create. The only difference is it's completely read-only. Each and every single user which has access to MySQL has access to this database, specifically to the fields and tables where one is allowed to access. And that's basically the information schema. This is going to be a totally new change for us. It's going to make all the porting and migration a lot easier, because all the other databases do it this way. They use information schema, which is going to make MySQL a lot more compatible in terms of migration back and forth between different databases. Do you have any questions regarding information schema? Next, this is one of my favorite subjects, precision math. Previously, precision math was not supported in MySQL. Precision math is just an amazing tool. I don't know if you ever tried, let's say for instance, I have a round example here. Did you ever try using the round command in Windows and then under Linux and noticed how you received different result sets? Because of the rounding precision, did that ever occur? What about when you tried it in 32-bit platforms, then went back to 64-bit platforms available now? Things were totally different. So, with precision math, one can actually obtain the same values regardless of the platform, regardless of how many bits the underlying processor is working on. So, if you're doing, for instance, geometrical data, and you have floating points all over, precision math all over, with this, you can be absolutely sure when we use mathematical functions, the results you receive are going to be exactly the same platform independently, which this obviously takes a lot of overhead from us, because previously that was impossible to accomplish with this, but it's totally platform independent. Now, another really nice part about precision math is it doesn't introduce floating point errors. And calculations are a lot more precise. By floating point errors, I mean, let's say you divide by zero, for instance. In previous versions, let's say 4.0, if you divided the value by zero, you would receive a null value. Now, with precision math, you can actually say, hey, this is an error. You can treat it as an error. So you say, this is an error. Let's treat this in a certain specified manner. So that would obviously translate into less buggy software, because after all, you're eliminating a bunch of possibilities there. Another really interesting part is control over handling invalid values. You probably saw a bunch of times when you're inserting, let's say you had a decimal 5:2. And you tried to insert a value which was a lot bigger than what the field could actually hold. What happened previously is the value was truncated. It was truncated to actually fit into the column that had previously defined. Now, well, that was totally wrong, because you could actually receive data which was totally false, was not correct. And this way, you can deny the insertion, you can insert a new field, you can actually specify what you want to insert. So again, just like with floating point errors, this takes mathematical handling of MySQL to a totally new level, which will make applications a lot safer and a lot faster. A lot faster development-wise, a lot faster in terms of debugging. Any questions regarding the position? Questions? Stored procedures. Stored procedures is basically divided into two. We have the procedures and the functions. Procedures are basically They work just like any other procedure in any procedural language. They will not return values. They just modify and handle data inside. Where functions, those can be used by themselves, statements and things like that. Talking about the benefits of these two. Well, first of all, there's a bunch of benefits in using stored procedures. There's a lot of developers that would actually argue this point. Some of them say that all the logical part of the application should reside on the server, and then there's the other group of people could argue that it should reside in the client. So this is basically something for each and every one of us as application developers to design. For instance, before MySQL supported stored procedures, each and every person that developed using MySQL implicitly used stored procedures, but the other side would be the client side. Now, today, the procedures will reside in the server, and there's a bunch of benefits. For instance, with stored procedures, one can be certain that they're going to be executed and run perfectly fine in their own environments. Previously, let's assume you had a Java application. Now let's say we're using floating point numbers, position high. You do not have the absolute certainty that the result from a certain procedure in one platform is going to be exactly the same as in another platform. So procedures, you take that part in the accountability, and you can actually handle it. You can be certain it's going to return the exact same result regardless of the platform. Another thing with this is the platform independence, which is basically the same as burning to all environments. This basically means you can actually have a 64-bit machine versus a 32-bit machine, and it will basically accomplish the same task. And the most important part of stored procedures is it will reduce network traffic. Stored procedures, they can take three parameters. In is the one used by default, out and in out. And I'm going to show a couple of examples showing how each and every one of these parameters is used. For instance, in this example, I'm using an in parameter. What this is basically just takes an argument to the stored procedure and uses it. As we can see here in the example, we have a really simple stored procedure which sets a value of variable x to the argument that we see, the global variable x. So for instance, assuming the stored procedure, if you would call it with a depconf 2006, and then sell data back again, you would receive depconf 2006. The value would not be modified. Going to the out. The out basically changes the argument. So in this particular example, we set the value of the environment variable x, depconf 2006. Create a stored procedure that receives an out parameter, bar power, and sets its value of p. So whenever we keep in mind we have a value set to depconf 2006, whenever one calls the stored procedure, it tells the environment variable, the result will be maximum in this particular example. And last but not least, in and out arguments. These are basically just a mix between the other two. So in this example, for instance, we call the example stored procedure with 2, multiplies it by 2, and returns. So procedures are still in really early stages of development. They basically support everything that they're supposed to nowadays. Now, stored functions. Functions is basically the same as they basically accomplish what UDFs used to accomplish previously. Stored procedures were supported. Basically, what a function is you can actually use it in the setup statement and use a result in the rest of the calculations. For instance, in this example, we created the weighted average function, which returns an integer. It is deterministic because the function always knows what kind of value it will return, depending on the arguments. And as you can see in the example,
the average for these arguments, the average was 4.
We still have a bunch of limitations to write sort of procedures. Currently, one cannot use log tables or log tables. Neither can one use load data or load table. These limitations will probably be removed in linear versus MySQL, probably 5.2. Will basically depend on what the current load is. In functions do have a bunch of limitations currently that will also be removed sometime in the future. Statements that do implicit or explicit rollbacks are limited. Statements that return results that are not supported, as well as prepared statements or variables statements, simple statements, and flush statements are going to be able to support. Triggers. Triggers are supported by MySQL 5. We support before insert on, after insert on, before update on, before delete on, and after delete on. Basically, triggers are worded for insert and update statements. One can use complex SQL statements and triggers. And reading and changing values are being inserted is currently supported too. An example of a trigger here is, for instance, here. In this example, we created a table that receives a tiny argument. Then we created the trigger, which basically what it does is for each row in the arguments, it will basically just add one to the value. So for instance, in this case, when we insert into the table, we insert one, and then check the value of the variable x. If it was in the direction of something too. Triggers are working pretty well nowadays. They are pretty trustworthy in terms of reliability and bugs. They left the beta status in 5.016. Views are also supported by MySQL. One of the nice features, a bunch of customers ask for them, a bunch of users ask for them. And views, what they basically are is they work as virtual tables, which are defined using queries. The interesting thing about views is one can have really complex queries that at the end of the day represent data as if they were a table. And they're not really subsets of tables, because they can be, for instance, active or passive. Now, in active views, the data is, active views can be updated like passive views. Therefore, data can, there's only four criteria which need to be met by the view in order to be active. And those criteria are basically that the data has to be selected from one single only table. The cell statement must not be a distant query. The cell statement may not contain any group by or having clauses. And no union operators can be expected correctly. As long as you meet those criteria, the view will be updated. Now this one here is probably my favorite inclusion in 5.0 statements. This is actually a 5.1 feature. It is not an ASCII standard. And basically what it is, it's called an event schedule. Basically what this is you can define a timestamp. For instance, let's go through this example, and I'll explain exactly what it does. For instance, here we created the table. Then when we created an event, we said, hey, why not schedule something occurs each and every second that goes by. So we create an event specifying the 1 second interval, and each and every time the event occurs, we will insert a value in the table we created above. Afterwards, we enable the event scheduler, and as you can see from the results from table result off of table T, you can see how an event is generated each and every second. For instance, here you can see 1759.51, 5253, and had this example taken longer, you would see the rest of the numbers. This is really cool because you can actually specify any kind of time interval you want, for instance, seconds, minutes, hours, months, years, and all that. This basically takes care of the new features out of the time code. As you can see, basically MESCO is striving to provide enterprise-grade reliability and performance in accordance to the SQL 2003 standard. Do you have any questions? Any questions regarding MySQL on its own? We're working really close with Sean Finney. Sean Finney is the guy that manages and maintains the MySQL done, especially on the bug side, where security bug, where there's a lot of communication between us and him regarding security bugs and things like that. That is basically what we're doing with Debian right now, in terms of supporting Debian guys, Debian.